Morning, members. Information papers issued since the last meeting. There is a letter dated 22nd of October 2019 from Dr Fernando CHEUNG requesting a panel to discuss protection of children's rights through legislation and his proposed amendments to the Protection of Children and Juveniles Ordinance. And also items for discussion at the next meeting. The next meeting is scheduled for the 9th of December 2019, a Monday at 10:45. To discuss the following. Item 1, briefing on the proposed members' bill to amend the Protection of Children and Juveniles Ordinance and the Juveniles Offenders Ordinance. And number 2, crisis support for sexual violence victims. So we will have a go at these items at the next regular meeting. And we will have a special meeting in December to discuss the rehabilitation plan. That's item 6 in the outstanding item list of outstanding items. We're going to hear the deputation at that meeting. I saw some hands. Is it for the first round? All right, and very quickly, we move on to the next item, providing one-off extra allowance to recipients of social security payments and a working family allowance and work incentive transport subsidy. All members have been invited to attend this meeting. Just a reminder that Rules of Procedure 83A provides that members with direct or indirect pecuniary interest are not supposed to move any motion or amendments. So if you have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest, please make the disclosure before taking the floor. I'd like to welcome the administration to this conference. And members have been given the background paper by the Secretariat. Thank you. With us for this item, Mr. Casper Choi, Undersecretary for Labour and Welfare, Ms. Alice Wong, Principal Executive Officer, Ms. Michelle Lam, Assistant Director of Social Welfare Department, and Mr. Andrew Kwan, Senior Statistician. Without further ado, I'd like to invite the administration to brief us on the paper. Chairman, thank you. We have regard to the economic situation in Hong Kong, and in order to deal with the challenging external and local environment, the Financial Secretary announced on 15th of August 2019 a series of measures to support enterprises, safeguard jobs, and relieve people's burden. There is a measure to provide one-off extra allowance to recipients of social security payments. And that include the old age allowance, old age living allowance, and disability allowance. Similar arrangements also apply to recipients of the WFA and IWITs. At the Finance Committee, on the day this is approved, all the eligible recipients will be eligible for the one-off extra allowance. We anticipate that 1.33 million people or recipients will stand to benefit. As to the WFA and IWITs, we anticipate that 57,000 and 32,000 people will benefit respectively. For the financial implications, the allowance will entail an estimated expenditure of $3.88 billion for the Social Security payments, $136 million for the WFA and $19 million for the IWITS. We will submit shortly to the Finance Committee for proposal upon funding approval. The Social Welfare Department and the Working Family and Student Financial Assistance Agency will be adjusting the computer system to disperse the one-off payments a month after FC's funding approval is sought at the earliest, and the money will be disbursed by auto-pay to the designated bank accounts, and there will not be any requirement to make separate applications. The relevant departments will publicize the implementation arrangements for various payments and allowances as appropriate, and I look forward to hearing members' views. Thank you very much, Under Secretary. I heard Mr. Michael Teen, Mr. Michael Look, and Mr. Fernando CHEUNG. Mr. Michael Teen, Under Secretary, this is not the first time I talked about this, and I refused to be succumbed. I mean, I would raise this issue as the opportunity arises. So, is there any relationship between the CSS payment and the actual needs? There are some concerned groups who said that the series of indices were put together in the 1990s, and inflation has been creeping up continuously. The way of life has changed so much compared with 20 years ago. About 2 decades ago, we didn't have any fees for telecommunication, the handsets and all the rest of it, and society has also changed considerably. In my retail business, in my garment business, people are buying less garment because they have to spend on items elsewhere. I've always hoped that the administration will review the situation to ascertain what, in this day and age, what the expenditure would include. I'm not sure how much this will turn out to be. Maybe it's going to be lower than what it is at the moment. My question for the Undersecretary is this. Are you sure you are not going to conduct such a review? I've never heard any intention to carry out such a review. Undersecretary, thanks very much. And Mr. Teen, we noticed that for CSSA, we are carrying out some reviews, like employment support. We do have a whole host of enhancement measures. This will be for the next item. What about the basic allowance? Yes, indeed. We have been paying attention to the distribution for the CSSA households. In terms of expenditure, as our society changes, there are varying expenditure. There is a drop in the electronic items, for instance, but for the CSSA households mainly, they're spending on food and so on. We are doing some rebalancing regarding the household expenditure. That work has already started in October. My colleague can fill us in on the details. Yes, turn up the mic for Mr. Kwan. Yes, we have the household expenditure survey, which cover from October this year to September next year. The findings will be available in 2022. Mr. Teen, so you're commissioning the academics. I know it's done by the Census and Statistics. It is on an annual basis regarding the household expenditure for the CSSA households. When will this become available? Expenditure items. Is it a regular exercise? Well, this is every 5 years. We look at the SSAIP. Now, when will the findings be available? In 2022. 2021, I beg your pardon. So two more years away. We have to cover up till September next year. So you have new ideas then? We will get to know about the expenditure pattern. So will this be similar to the situation in the 1990s? Well, we cannot preempt the findings. Well, you said every 5 years. Every 5 years. So from the 1990s, you do this every 5 years, and so it would be you'll be looking at a whole basket of things as you did in the 1990s. Chairman, as I said, as time goes by, people's expenditures are changing as well. Like I said, the expenditure on electronic items has dropped, and in terms of food and dining, the spending has gone up. We need a longer time because a lot of expenditure falls within the seasonal cycle, and we have to have at least 1 year to look at different seasons. Well, the census and statistics does this every 5 years. Now, my question is, 5 years back, when you last did it, the findings, were they similar to the whole basket of issues back in 1990s? Chairman, we do have the information. We can supplement the information after the meeting. Every 5 years, now, if it is similar to 20 years ago, it doesn't make any difference whether you do it or not. Well, no, we'll supplement the information. Mr. Leung Yu-chung, Chairman, a lot of the members of the public are telling us that with this one-off allowance, they are anxious to know when this will be dispersed. The sum is not particularly high, and with this one-off allowance, that doesn't make a lot of difference to their life. So my question is this. I share members' views. Can the original allowance be adjusted? If you just offer them a one-off allowance, it may not be good enough.
Of course, you know, for some citizens, this is better than none, but I don't think this is a long-term solution because you just give people the impression that you are just putting up a political show and give out a one-off extra allowance. So this is not an ideal situation. Also, you are not able to change some of the procedures. For example, in terms of the eligibility for WIS and WFA, we have asked you to change it, but you won't take that into account. And you just tell us that you will review them later. We're looking at the minutes of our previous meetings. The Secretariat has provided with a paper. And every time, it is stated that a lot of our colleagues have pointed out this is not an ideal situation. And the ideal situation is to change the threshold and increase the amount of allowance. This has been a persistent request from us. But every time, we are just talking to an empty wall, and you're not responding to us. So I really want to know whether you would seriously take into account the eligibility for CSSA and increase the amount of the standard rates. In terms of WIS and WFA, only a few number of people are benefiting from it, from them. So we always wonder whether there are more people out there who need these assistance. So I think it is because you put up a high threshold so they cannot apply for it. So repeatedly, we've been asking this question and the Secretariat has put the same point in the paper. And then in future, you will give us the same answer again. But I won't stop here. I will be very persistent. I will keep asking the same question. But this is not a good repetitive cycle. I hope you will seriously take our questions into account. So how can we break off this cycle? Well, Mr. Chairman, if you look at the past few years, we have been trying to enhance our schemes, and we have listened to the views of members and the public, and we have responded to your requests and demand. If you look at the WFA, you notice that we have changed the name from LIFA to WFA. We have also changed the method for application, and we have also changed the amount of the allowance. And for the child allowance, we also have a substantial increase and enhancement. If we look at the WFA, we have about 900,000 people benefiting from the scheme, from 56,000 households. And we have now received more than 60,000 applications from 16,000 households. This is an increase. So prior to the policy address, I have been meeting the members of the public, and they have reflected to us that WFA has helped them to secure jobs and is helpful to them. So this time round, if we are looking at this item, we are giving a one-off extra allowance. And as I said at the beginning of this session, we have raised this issue in August, taking into account the latest economic situation in Hong Kong. So we suggested that we dish out a one-off extra allowance this time. If there are other suggestions, of course, we'll be happy to listen to them and discuss with you. So Mr. Chairman, are you giving us the same answer? So you're not going to look at the eligibility for application? You're not going to change the thresholds at all? Well, Mr. Chairman, we'll be happy to continue to discuss with members. Next one, the Honorable Pun Xiuping. Thank you, Chairman. I think we are now facing an economic downturn, and there will be a lot of financial pressure on our citizens. The administration's proposal of giving out a one-off extra allowance, I support that in principle. And I hope that you will put your proposal to the Finance Committee as soon as possible. But you are saying that even with FC's approval, you need one month's time before you can disburse the funds. So now we have a lot of items queuing for the FC. I wonder why you always need 1 month before you can dish out the disbursement. Can you do it within 1 month after FC approval? Can you do it quicker? Second question. Some other colleagues have raised a similar point. They have pointed out that some of the rates have not been changed for a long time. For example, the WIS is only $300 and $600. It has been there since 2001. So it is not enough at all for the applicants. So I would like to know whether you have a timetable for reviewing the WIS. The third point, I will refer to paragraph 7 of the paper. The paper teaches about that the scheme is WFA is benefiting about 50,000 households. But in 2019, during the budget in February then, you told us that there are some 80,000 applications and some 17,000 applications have been approved. So are you still processing some of the applications? So I wonder why there is a discrepancy between the number of applications and the number of households being benefited from the WFA. So what are the application procedures and how many applications are in the pipeline are still being processed? Thank you, Chairman. On the statistics concerning the WFA, if we look at the latest figures, we have about 148,000 applications, and we will keep an eye on the situation. I think so far we have approved some 130,000 applications, and the number of applicants is about 190,000, and the households concerned about 67,000, and there are still some 80,000 applications. So some people have stopped applying for the WFA. So if you take that into account, the sums more or less add up. So we've been liaising with the applicants and see how we can assess them to process their applications. Members may wish to note that during the enhancement process, applications can be received online starting from September. Can I interject? Why do you think that there are only 50,000 households benefiting from them? So there should be more. So the funds are not enough, is that correct? Oh, these are only ballpark figures. If you look at the past situation, some families are eligible, but that does not mean that they would apply for it. And even if they apply for it, their living situation may have changed and they don't need it anymore. So I would ask my colleagues to supplement on the figures. Please switch on your mic. Ms. Wong? Chairman, I would like to supplement some figures. For the 140,000 cases, it is referring to the number of applications. For the 50,000 households, we are talking about the number of households that benefit from the scheme. So these applications are coming from about 60,000 households. So we have approved about 560,000 households so far. So about 50,000 households are receiving the WFA, and we think that they will continue to apply and benefit from the scheme. Next, Dr. Fernando CHEUNG.
Thank you, Chairman.
Well, this morning a lot have happened, Mr. Chairman. We can see that there are gunshots being fired, people get hurt, and they are hospitalized. And we notice that the police have marched into university campuses. And then there are a lot of incidents at the university compounds. So it is very chaotic outside, and it's not easy for us to have a meeting here. But I do appreciate that there are some policies that need to be carried on within this chamber and need to be discussed here. This one-off extra allowance to the needy is very important, but I think it always comes too late and too less. I appreciate the points made by the Honorable Michael Tin. We are in a civic society, and we have been talking about this for years. We have been asking whether the standard rates under the CSSA, which is supposed to help the vulnerable, can really benefit them and be reasonable for them so that they can have a reasonable living. So you have to be an accurate amount to help them. And this amount was set some 20 years ago. It was accurate then, but it is very outdated now. If you look at the table, for a single able-bodied adult, the amount is only $2,525 per month. So it is on average only $84 per day. So the recipient has to spend this on food, you know, clothing, transport, etc. I just really don't know how many people can survive on this. This is a very low living level. We have been urging the administration for years to set up a threshold and review the case, but you have not been doing it. And even for the single abled adults, they have been paying a lot on rental. The rent allowance is not sufficient to cover the exact rent they pay. It can only cover about 60% of them. So please tell me, for the single able-bodied adult, they are trying to rent for subdivided flats. How much do they have to pay on top of the rent allowance? I think they have to pay an extra of several $100 to $1,000. Or how much is left for them for other uses? So I think this is really, really not adequate. I hope you will tell me when you will really have a comprehensive review of the CSSA and a survey of people's needs on keeping a living. Well, thank you, the Honorable Fernando CHEUNG. I think this is a difficult task, but we have to spend time to review how we can help the needy in society. Undersecretary? Well, if members look at the next agenda item, we will be talking about the CSSA. But I would like to let you know that for the recipients of the CSSA, they also receive supplements. And I think in general, they have about $6,000 to $10,000 per month. So I think we should not just look at the monthly standard rates. We should also look at the situation of the recipients. We agree that we should look into that. And if we look at the past figures, we can see that recipients who are renting private housing, they would need room for improvement, and that's why in this policy address we have some details to help them, and I will defer that and let you have the details during the discussion of next agenda item. And to respond to the Honorable Mr. Poon, This is a one-off extra allowance, and I think it will be helpful to some of the grassroots families. And we hope that we can come to FC as soon as possible. And we'll keep an eye on the progress. Chairman, he has not answered my question at all. I'm asking when they will do a review. They did it back in 1996. When is the next time that you're going to review it, Undersecretary? Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. On the review of the CSSA, we have reviewed some of the pro-employment measures, and we have a series of improvement measures. And we'll talk about that at the next agenda item. And I don't want to repeat myself here. So, second round of questions. The Honourable Lok Chung Hong. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have been affected by some of the protesters when I travel to Legislative Council. I really try hard to make my way to my place of work and for me to come back to the Legislative Council to deliver my duty as an honourable member of LegCo. So I would like to ask the administration, this is a difficult time and we have to stop violence first, but I think we need to have policy which really meets the needs of our community and help people who are vulnerable and in need. I am concerned about the WFA. This is a very good scheme with good intention. You are encouraging people to take up employment and they are working but they still can't make ends meet. So for the members of my union, they always come to us for helping the filling of the applications forms for WFA. For some of the applicants, they receive different allowance during different months because the working hours differ during the months. For the highest month, whether that should be taken into account, and for the or alternatively, should we take the average number according to the latest month? So there are a lot of questions concerning this. The second point concerns about working hours. I know the government has the philosophy of encouraging people to work. So if you work more, you have more allowance under the WFA.
If they chalk up less working hours, does it mean that people are getting more lazy? I think this is a disrespect for the Hong Kong people. I mean, despite the situation in Hong Kong, people are trying very hard to get to work. And this is very much our core values. So in terms of working hours, can there be any relaxation? Now, you need 192 hours for the full rate. You're assuming that they are working 48 hours per week. That this is not a healthy lifestyle. Standard working hours, 44 hours. Although this has not been as codified, you go beyond the normal hours, 44 hours. I mean, you have to work beyond 44 hours before you would be able to get the full rate or the half rate. Will there be any review on the part of the government to lower the level to, let's say, 40 hours or 44 per week instead of 48 hours per week? Also, the lowest threshold, it is 144 hours per month. I'm talking about the non-single-parent households. Chairman, there are many people who are keen to work, but the economic situation means that they cannot work, and some of them are on low-paid leave, and they are working casual jobs. And tourism sector is the hardest hit. People suffer from a drop in their working hours by 50% or more. Now, some are working less than 144 hours per month. And this is not a low threshold to start with. And they will end up with no allowance whatsoever. At the worst crisis, they don't even get any allowance. Will there be any review on the part of the government in this regard? Chairman, very briefly, if you look at the figures, those on full rate, 90% of them are on full rate. For single parent households, we do have a separate calculation methodology. So we do address different household needs and different composition. For the WIT, you understand that we have added the medium rate so that people will be encouraged to hold down a job. Chairman, thank you. In terms of working hours, let me supplement. In April 2018, when the WFA was launched, one of the measures was to have the working hours aggregated so that there would be more flexibility in the application. Now, the member asked about how we work out the extra allowance. During the applicable period, if they have put in application for WIT and was approved, now that's on a month-by-month basis. We would take an average for the application month and award the allowance accordingly. I hope that the working hours should be reviewed. I understand the aggregation has made a little bit of difference, but that's not gone far enough. They're working less and end up with virtually nothing. All right, this will be noted. And Mr. Xu Kajun, Vice Chair. Chairman, thank you. Well, the government is acting like a tit for tat against the protesters. Now, the Undersecretary is going round and round in circle in his reply. I think it is making life even more difficult for the people. Now, I've got two questions here. The government has to take some measures to alleviate the plight of the public. That much I understand. Now, these measures to dish out the sweetness will not be the solution to the problem. The solution to the problem is to address the five demands, not one less. Now, these measures seem to be neither fish nor fowl. The situation is pretty challenging. The low-income people are suffering from lack of work. Now, the government's measures are to dish out additional sums for those working for 144 hours or longer. Shouldn't it be the case that the relief measures should target those who are suffering from a lack of work or underprovided with work? At the beginning of the year, we said that the government is really harsh to the underprivileged. The government introduced the supplement to make up for the difference in their pay. Now, the problem still hasn't gone away. The government tries to plug the loopholes, but the problem still hasn't gone away. For those between 60 and 65, they lose. They stand to lose $1,060 as a result of the tightening of the threshold. It seems that the government thinks that there is less demand on the part of those between 60 and 64 than those above 65. What justification do you have to say that those between 60 and 64 would need less than anybody beyond 65? Undersecretary, when the member asked, talked about the economic situation having a bearing on the people who are suffering from joblessness and also from under provision of work, that we do have measures to support enterprises and to safeguard jobs. I've had opportunity to meet the grassroots families. They are concerned. They are concerned about not being able to get to work. Given the chaotic situation in our society, how can we offer them some assistance? The first thing is to quell the violence to start with, because otherwise, however many measures we have, people simply cannot get to work, and enterprises cannot survive, and it would be really hard for us to offer them any effective help. So I would urge that the illegal behaviors should cease forthwith. Now back to the subject today, regarding the disbursement of one-off allowance, and this is intended to alleviate the burden. And this is the fifth time we're doing this. We hope that different departments will be able to do something to help the grassroots people. And with this one-off allowance, we hope that these can be dispersed as soon as possible. I hope that this can be dispersed to the public who are in need. How can you justify that those between 60 and 64 would need less than those beyond 65? Chairman, this has been discussed before. In terms of allowance for able-bodied people, they are not getting anything less in the new arrangement. In our review of the CSSA, in fact, at the next item, we're going to have a go at the enhancement measures, and I've got nothing to add. Mr. Wilson Orr, Chairman, I can see from this paper that the government is anxious to help the grassroots people through these one-off measures. I am supportive of this paper, but I'm concerned about one thing, and this is the concern of the public. According to the paper, paragraph 10, it says that this will be submitted to the Finance Committee for approval. My question for the Undersecretary is this: how soon are you going to make it to the Finance Committee? I know that you get stuck with many items, but I think you have to have a timetable. Now, these are relief measures. Given the situation in Hong Kong, the salary people, the workers, are really troubled. We are entering into the worst of winter, and these relief measures should come as good news for them. These people have been neglected by the government for so long. So my question is, what is the timeline for this item being submitted to the Finance Committee? I'm sure you must have a timetable. You also said that 1 month after the approval, disbursement will take place. Now, you may make it sound really good, but the $4,000 is disbursement is really making me surprised. I mean, it's surprising me. Is there any room for you to telescope the process within this month? I hope that you should compress the process as soon as possible. I agree that we should think of long-term measures, but with these immediate relief measures, you shouldn't. I mean, you shouldn't drag your feet for too long. Can you compress this within this month? I've urged the administration to enhance the WFA and also the WITS. The administration told us that in April 2018, some enhancement measures were adopted. Now, it did make a little bit of difference, tiny, tiny bit of difference, but I can tell you that when I met the grassroots workers, they're telling me that the casual workers who do not measure up to the working hours will not stand to benefit. I think you have to help people to the hilt. For the casual laborers, given the challenging economic situation, I'm wondering whether you can relax the criteria more, or you shouldn't, your colleagues shouldn't make life difficult for these people. And I think they are very mean. They are making life very, very difficult for the applicants. Will the application procedures be streamlined to help these people? Also, EMs, ethnic minorities. You said that you're helping a lot, helping them in many different ways. Now, the EM people are telling me that when they are filling out the forms, they will have to do it many, many times over. They have to do it multiple times. Will you make it convenient for the ethnic minorities to make application? I hope that these grassroots people will be assisted. You have to have your finger on the pulse of the public. Under Secretary, we are just as concerned about the timetable. We are queuing up for our slot. There may be just one item being approved every week. I am just as anxious as members. I cannot see when, although I would try to seek an early slot as much as possible. As to telescoping the process, we will have to fine-tune a computer system. We've done it many times, and I hope that this can get through. Let's go. I know that for the $4,000 payout, people have been asking us for more information. And as I said, people don't have to make a separate application. It will be done by auto pay. Now, for the WITS, they can make application online. We try to streamline the procedure. And we've asked the NGOs to see how assistance can be offered. We are monitoring the data, and we hope that the application procedures can be smoothened as much as possible. Now, for the first time applicant, it will be difficult because they have to gather all the data. But once they've got a hang of it, it would be pretty easy. And we will continuously listen to members' views and see how the existing procedures can be enhanced. And it's my turn next. I'm grateful to members, and I mean we're having this meeting in a somber atmosphere, and I think we have to pursue this matter.
Well, I think none of the members opposed to the proposal of giving out one-off extra allowance to the recipients of CSSA, WFA, and WITS. But I think this is just a very small support, and I think it is not enough. Well, for the CSSA or related allowance recipients, they are all from the vulnerable groups, and this one-off extra allowance is not sufficient. Well, as indicated in the paper, the Financial Secretary has indicated on the 15th of August that there will be enhancement measures to support enterprises and safeguard jobs. And I hope the government will do more, because this one-off extra allowance of 1 month is not enough. And I hope the government would use other measures. And I hope that in the near future, you would consider other measures like giving out another 1 month allowance, or don't use the monthly as a basis. Try to give out targeted measures and give an adequate amount to help targeted groups. It can be given out under the CSSA or under the WFA. Now we're in November 2019, and there is still time before the end of the financial year. So if the members of the Welfare Services panel make a suggestion to the government to ask you to take into account to give another month's extra allowance, would you take that into account? Thank you, Chairman. Well, Chairman has pointed out that the disbursement of this 1 month extra was announced in August. And we have been trying to impose measures to support enterprises, safeguard jobs, and relieve people's burden. And there are other measures which have been implemented. Now we have a rather chaotic situation, and a lot of grassroots families are not having full employment. their jobs are being affected. So we have multiple measures to help them. And I think that in the near future, there will be other measures. When they are ready, we will announce them and try to help people to alleviate their burden. So I think different bureaucrats will try to help out and help our citizens, because this is a really very difficult economic situation for the whole of Hong Kong. And I appreciate that members have been expressing your views to us on different occasions. We have been listening very carefully, and we have been looking into their feasibility. And government as a whole will try to see how we can help our citizens. So Chairman, we'll be happy to listen to your views and hear your suggestions and continue our dialogue. And I hope that if there is a need to have extra measures, we will certainly seriously consider that. Well, I just want to supplement that during this welfare services panel, I think a lot of members do not, not any member would object to dishing out 1 month extra allowance. Well, on the paper, it is stated that you are going to spend $3,888 million, and I think the government can certainly afford that. And I hope the government will really seriously consider that measures that you announced in August are only being dished out, you know, after November. So it's now about time for you to think of another round of measures. Please consider whether you can give out another month's extra allowance to the recipients. I don't see any sort of questions for the second round, so let's move on to the other agenda item. And I would like to reiterate that the government will come to the Finance Committee as soon as possible to get our approval, and I hope the administration will really come to the FC as soon as possible. So let's move on to the next agenda item. It is the review of pro-employment measures and other improvement measures under the CSSA scheme, as well as annual adjustment of social security payments. So usually for the first meeting of the welfare services panel, we will discuss this agenda item. So please invite the administration to join us. We have the Secretary for Labor and Welfare, Mr. Johan Wong, Deputy Secretary for Labor and Welfare, Mr. Donald Ng, Head of the WFS FAA, Mr. Andrew Wan and Ms. Michelle Lam will remain with us to answer questions. So, would I like to invite the administration to introduce the paper first. Thank you, Chairman. I will let you have my speech. And I think we have been talking about these issues at our last meeting and also during meetings concerning the policy address. So I don't want to repeat them. But I would like to just clarify a few points because we have heard some views from the public. Well, during the policy address, we have pointed out that we will increase the rent allowance. And for the inflations due to adjustments, we have stated in the paper that for the rent allowance, it will be increased by about 3%. But of course, we have to wait until the end of the month, and then we will have more precise figures. But I think for today, I think it is quite likely to have an increase of about 3% for the rent allowance increase. So I hope you will appreciate that there will be some deviation. So for $2,400, 3% of that doesn't equate to $1,800. So I would welcome questions from members. First round of questions, Mr. Michael Tin, Vice Chair, Mr. Wilson Oh, and etc. So Mr. Michael Tin first. Mr. Secretary, nice to see you again. Well, last time we had a meeting and I asked you the question whether you can increase the rental allowance, whether for CSSA recipients or the people who are not receiving any allowance at all, the know-nothings. Well, you were saying at that time that there is a possibility, and you say it is a concern, but this is a difficult situation. You said something like that. And then there was a meeting of the Transport and Housing Panel. And then I asked the Secretary, Mr. Chen, STH, if there is an increase in the rental allowance and there is the side effect of rent increase as a whole, then it will be meaningless. So who will be responsible for studying the relationship between the two? Because it's logical that you would need to look into rent control. But then there are people who are also concerned that some of the property owners wouldn't rent out their properties at all. Well, so STH said at that time that I have good analysis. I do not know exactly what he meant. I don't know whether he agreed or disagreed with me. But he said that SLW would look into the matter, and he would look into the implications of increasing the rental allowance and also the increase in rents as a whole. So that means your bureau will be responsible for that. So I would like to ask whether you would really review the matter within this year. What is the impact of increase in rent allowance on the rentals in Hong Kong? If you would do that single-handedly, then how can you share your findings with us? And if you say that there is no impact, then I have nothing to ask. But I think a lot of people, they are still thinking that there should be partial rent control, because the rent allowance that they are receiving may not be adequate. So that will be a different story. And I think I need to talk to THB on that. So SLW, I would like to know whether you will study the relationship between the increase in rent allowance and rentals in Hong Kong on your own. Thank you. At the last meeting, I was not present, so I do not know precisely what STH has said. But in the policy address, it was stated that before the end of the coming year, the government will study whether we would adjust the rent allowance for citizens who are waiting for public rental housing and living in private housing, how we can help this group. For Mr. Michael Tin, he's asking about the impact of the rent allowance on rentals in Hong Kong. But today we are talking about the CSSA under the maximum rent allowance. So the amount of households being affected is not that many. So I do not think that such a small adjustment will affect a lot of households and will impact on the market, the rental market as a whole. But to study the relationship between the two, I think the best thing is to do an experiment. But I haven't done similar experience before. So even if you give me one more year, I don't think I will be able to study the relationship between the two, i.e. the increase in rent allowance and the rental market. But if you look at other documents, there may be some information to help us to consider the matter as a whole. When we study the impact of rent allowance increase and rental market, it is not within my ambit. So thank you very much. So it seems that what you're saying is different from what STH has said. I have actually moved a motion which has been passed, and I requested THB and yourself to join hands to study this, because I am surprised to say that you would review this on your own, that is the impact between the increase in rent allowance and the rental market. I think it's obvious that the two bureaus would have to work together on this. Well, STH said at that time that he would work closely with LWB and would try to complete the study in a timely manner. This is what he said. So I would like to know whether you will be joining hands with him and do a joint study. Thank you. SLW? I would like a response from him. Well, you have several meetings in a weak, and I try to pull you guys together. And I'm trying to be the go-betweener. So I would like to know whether you will work with STH. Well, Chairman, I think I have more or less answered the question. I will be working with THB, and within the end of next year, we will try to see how we can give an allowance to the low-income groups to help them. Well, you have not responded to my question. STH said that he would work with you to study the impact between the increase in rent allowance and the rental market. So I'm asking you, SLW, if STH comes to you on this, will you cooperate or will you reject him and turn him away? Secretary, well, Chairman, I think I have said earlier that this is not within the ambit of our study. So are you saying a no? If the STH comes to you, you will reject him? Is that correct? Mr. Tin, I would suggest that you ask that during your second round. Vice Chair? Thank you, Chairman. Well, at 8 a.m. this morning, I was having a meeting with the Hong Kong Council of Social Service and another party, and we talked about the review of the CSSA because it is not easy to have such a review. They know that we have a meeting this morning, and they would like to know whether there will be a review report. They would like to know whether the administration would put the review report onto the website of SWD and LWB so that the public will have access to them. So please give me a straight answer. This is a simple question, yes or no. Another question is from myself. Well, throughout this paper, I noticed that there are some guiding principles concerning the last review of the CSSA. And we all know that the basis was back in 1996. And then in 1999, there was another review of the able-bodied CSSA recipients and also the employment support for them. So for 1999, the review is not a comprehensive one. But then your paper said that it was a comprehensive review, so I do not agree with that. That wasn't a comprehensive review. Another point, the paper has included three guiding principles. Whether there is a genuine need, whether there are temporary financial assistance, I think these are rather misguided principles. Because back in 1996, there were no guiding principles for the review. There were only policy objectives, which was stated back in 1991, the white paper on social welfare then.
And that is to help those with material needs. That the guiding principles here have overshadowed the objective. And that's why the government introduced the policy of adjusting the senior citizens' CSSA upward from 60 to 65. And that's undermining people's incentive to work. My question for the administration is, who is in need? Those who do not have any disability doesn't mean that they don't have the need. Has the government reviewed the inadequacy of the guiding principles? Also, in the review for the able-bodied people, they don't have any removal allowance. What is the justification? And those who've gone beyond the rent allowance, they're not given any supplementary allowance, no removal allowance, and people find it very difficult to move to accommodation which charges lower rent. Now, you said that those with economic and material needs, you would offer them assistance. I'm wondering whether these should be redrafted as a result. Secretary? Well, there are so many elements in Mr. Xu's question. I don't know how I should address them all. Now, simply put, we don't have any report. We have a cross-departmental committee, which is tasked to address specific issues. We did have a conclusion, and we had a paper as a result, which was submitted to the Executive Council for approval. Basically, the details are set out in the paper distributed to members today. And we don't have any report per se. In the CSSA, the needs that we're talking about are economic needs. The households or individuals, if their pay cannot meet the needs in our society, then they will be given assistance. That's in relation to economic needs. Now, you mentioned the removal allowance. We have relaxed the criteria. The single parent families can also be entitled to the removal allowance. I think we do see the need for that. In the moving house, they from time to time need to seek assistance from outside, and that will incur additional expenditure. So that justifies the allowance. Mr. Xiu, I regret that. I hope the members would be concerned about it. You don't even have any report resulting from the review. You don't have any report covering what you adopt, what you don't adopt. You just have the findings. I mean, is this a legitimate exercise, Secretary? We don't have a report arising from many studies. We would just compile a paper because of the change in policies. We need to bring the EXCO up to date and seek their endorsement. So in most of our review and study, we don't normally have a specific report. If members would, if we just act on reports, we may delay matters. Mr. Wilson-Walk, good morning, Mr. Secretary. I'm pleased to have you here because it's better to have some review than have no review at all, because otherwise the government will be stubborn regarding their work. I hope that I'd like to be able to bring up a number of points. The first one is the rental allowance. Every time we come across this at the panel, members are asking the government to raise the rent allowance. These CSSA recipients, they're living in rented private housing. They are under tremendous pressure. With a rental allowance, that would assuage their problems. Why is it that this adjustment is only a one-off exercise? Will you consider extending this increase? Will you test the market to see whether there will be any knock-on effects? Also, the rent allowance, we've been reminding, not so much criticizing, we've been reminding the government that with rent allowance, they should consider dealing with the rent control concurrently. I think the government should start with the SDUs, the subdivided units. We haven't seen any move in this regard. I'd like to hear from the administration. With rent allowance, why is it that we don't have any rent control? Also, I've received feedback from the grassroots people and the welfare organizations. I've been to the district, and they are telling me that Wilson, if they can help it, that they don't really want to count on the government. They sign on the dole because they are part of the grassroots. Now, for the able-bodied people, they don't have any medical allowance, and this is troubling them. I know that in this review, there is allowance for glasses and dental care for the able-bodied recipients. In 1999, we had the allowance in the medical area. There is no mention of that. And also for the chronically ill and non-elderly CSSA recipients, and also the able-bodied recipients, they don't have much in the way of medical allowance. They save and skim. They save and swim in order to save up enough to meet the medical bill. Now, for these classified as able-bodied recipients, would there be any allowance for them in terms of medical, also dental? The grassroots people are of the view that there should be further relaxation. And for the dental care dental clinics and they're offering dental care. Shouldn't they be included in the list offering dental care to the recipients? Secretary? Every year, the standard allowance in the CSSA is adjusted on an annual basis. There are two areas here. We are adjusting this on an annual basis. And paragraph 23, you get to see the calculation method. This is the one-off adjustment. As I said at the beginning, because of inflation, there may be a 3%. This is subject to confirmation by the end of the month. And this will be adjusted by 3% or thereabout. Now, that's because there are changes in the way people choose their accommodation. In the CSSA, we do not see a full picture of that. Many years ago, they had the best space apartments. Now we don't have that many best space apartments. They're living in cubicle apartments or subdivided units. So for the 1P household, we see an increase of 27.3% in terms of increase. Going forward, we will pay close attention to the situation. As a result of this hike this time, will there be any difference made to the rental? Now there is the CCF subsidy going on. We do have sufficient information to ascertain the situation as a result of the increase in rent allowance. Rent control, I think I can only scratch the surface because this is not within the purview of the LWB. With an increase in rent allowance, will there be any bearing on the rental level? I'll be looking at this together with the THB. Now for those CSSA recipients, if they use the hospital authority service, they will have their fees waived. If they do need certain consumables, I understand that the hospital authority would pick up the taps also, and there is no need for these to be picked up under the CSSA. Dental care, I heard what Mr. Wilson all said, there are 60 or so non-government dental clinics. The number would be quite sufficient. But as to whether this can be added as suggested by Mr. Orr, we can have a look. Dr. Fernando CHEUNG, Chairman, you're depriving people of the basic needs, and 20 years on, you say you're telling, you're giving back some of them. I am concerned about the arbitrariness of the whole thing. In 1999, you took away arbitrarily 11 items of allowance. At that time, I remember vividly, the report refers to a self-reliance, as alluded to in the paper. You're concerned that people are liable to become lazy and they are not prepared to work. Nothing can be further from the truth. After the financial turmoil in 1997, the wages have come down, and the government is saying that the CSSA is encouraging laziness, and people rather sign on the dole than work. And at that time, the whole thing, the whole allowance, whole set of allowance was slashed arbitrarily without any scientific basis, without any study. You just slash arbitrarily. Now you're giving back some of them. Rent allowance has or will be adjusted. But I think this time it's just as arbitrary. Mr. Srikajan has a point there. What justification do you have? What study have you conducted? You don't even have a report. The whole bunch of top officials are seem together and getting this done in an arbitrary way. You've done away with all these items of allowance. Today, you apply the same standard, apply the same criteria. You're giving back some of the allowance. Now for childcare, the rent deposit allowance, removal allowance, allowance for glasses, dental treatment, these are medical and rehabilitation related needs. These are part of their basic needs. Today, I think you're righting the wrong. There are so many people who are paying more than what they are granted for rent allowance. And with this adjustment, how many, what percentage of households are still paying rent more than the allowance? Now, with this adjustment, will there be any difference made to the situation where people are paying more in rent than the rental allowance? They said you take the average, you disregard the top 10% and the top bottom 10%. What difference would this make to the situation? In particular, those the percentage of people who are paying more in rent than the allowance. I got a WhatsApp from a disabled. He is saying that this is good, this is all well and good, but in the shelter workshops, there are so many disabled people who are getting paid $26.5 per day. They would very much like to stand on their feet. They're working full time, but there is no way they get a living wage. I hope that you would bear this in mind. Secretary, Chairman, if I may address Dr. Cheung's questions. In devising the maximum rent allowance, or MRA, we have to consider the reasonable level, and we adopted the average. We disregarded the top and bottom 10%. Now, there are some 1P household, and they're getting $9,000, and that's more than the CSSA payment. Some have gone beyond the reasonable level, and so we're adopting an average. Over the past couple of years, in the light of the experience there, when we adjust the MRA, the maximum rent allowance, the coverage rate, meaning those who don't pay rent exceeding the MRA, the number will reduce. After a year, the exceedance will increase. I think it has to do with the cycles, the adjustment cycles of the rent and so on. And after these adjustments, 8185 to going up to $2,400 for 1P household, I'm sure that the exceedance will come down.
And we hope that only about 40% of the CSSA recipients will be paying rent more than the rent allowance when they are renting private housing. So we would also take into account the changes in the coming years and see what would the impact be on the rental market. So you are changing the percentage from 60 to 40%. So this is just a slight improvement. Why can't you do more? Well, Chairman, when we are looking at this situation, we are actually facing a difficulty. Because on the one hand, the rent allowance is less than the market rental. So it is just reasonable that it should be adjusted. But we are now only looking at a single household. As an example, it can be increased from $5,000, $6,000 to around $9,000. Some are between the range of $7,000 to $8,000 per month. So we have to think about what is meant by a reasonable level. Also, we have to bear in mind that when we increase the maximum rental allowance, then the rents will increase generally. For example, today it is only about $1,885. Maybe he would use $1,000 for rental. If you increase that to $2,400, he may be renting a better place with a bigger flat, more convenient, and he is prepared to pay more for rental. Another example is that a person may be paying 2,000 for rent, which is above the MRA. And if we give them $2,400, they will still pay more in order to get a better living environment. So we can see that when you increase the MRA, the rental will increase as a whole because the recipient will be changing the flat that he rent as well. So it's not just the property owner increasing the rent. So this is not something that we can just work out according to a percentage. If you look at the coverage, the wider the coverage, maybe the rent increase will be higher. So this is a very difficult situation. So maybe we can ask more about that during the second round. We have Mr. Michael Tin and Mr. Kwok Wai Kong who want to ask questions. So please come back to the conference room if you hear the bell. And we now have a motion being moved by the Vice Chair, and we hope that members who can hear the broadcast can come back so that we will have enough quorum to discuss this motion. I also have a question myself. Mr. Secretary, I can see that recently you have stated in your website that the CSSA is helping the poor, but the impact is not that obvious now. In the past, it was about 3%, and it has now decreased to about 2.5% recently. Also, I hope we all understand that if you can have a proper rental housing, in about 5 years' time, you can really alleviate poverty a lot. But I'm also concerned that SLW, you are concerned about the effect of CSSA in helping the grassroots. It will not be very effective in helping the grassroots community. So would you consider in future, if you review the CSSA, would you take a step back to say that if CSSA is not effective, you will give less resources for the CSSA? So I'm concerned about that, because I think providing a flat, like a public housing unit for the needy, of course, is very helpful. This is very obvious, and I hope the STH will provide more public rental housing units. But I would like to hear your views. How are you going to prioritize the development of social security in future? Well, Chairman, I hope you would look at my paper and not just the report from the press. Last year, actually in 2018, around the latter half of that year, I have been discussing with my bureau and the SWD whether we need to review part of the CSSA. And we see that, you know, the effect of CSSA in alleviating poverty seems to be lessened over the years. Generally, we have lesser CSSA recipients, and also we try to review the CSS rate according to inflation. Recently, we've been looking at the median income of the CSSA household, and they seem to be deviating from the inflation rates. So therefore, the CSA is less effective in alleviating poverty. So it's not the other way around, as Mr. Chairman, as you said. So this year, this time we noticed that there are several areas that we have to improve. For some of the supplements, we have to enhance them. For the MRA, we have to increase it. And we noticed that a lot of the CSSA recipients are paying rent higher than the MRA. And also, they are receiving, they are using some of the standard rates for paying rental. So I hope that the increase in the MRA this time would help them a bit and alleviate their burden. And then also for the disregarded earnings, we have also increased it from 2,500 to 4,000. So as to how they can have the maximum disregarded earnings, their income would have to be around $6,800 per month. So we hope that this arrangement would help the able body and also the CSSA recipients who are able to work to try to join the labor market more and work harder. So we hope that either directly or indirectly, we will be able to encourage CSSA recipients to find a job and take up employment. So this is our objective. And we hope that in general, the CSSA will be able to help people who are under the poverty line. So second round, we have Mr. Michael Tin and Dr. Fernando Cheung. Mr. Michael Tin, your second round questions, please. Secretary, I am one of your friends. I just want to clarify some of the points. You said last time that your review is only on the disbursement of the help to the community. And the Secretary for Transport and Housing said that your review would cover rental allowance. So he's talking about just rental allowance, not just for CSSA recipients, but also for the know-nothings. So he said that you will study the impact or the relationship between the increase in MLA and the rental market. I was a bit surprised because I don't think that should fall within your purview. That's why I asked you whether STH has misunderstood the issue or you will study it. But you said that you will only study how to disperse the funds to the recipients. So is that correct? And I think that's correct, right? You have also said that any of the cash allowance or supplements are for the low-income groups, and it may induce an increase in rent, but you don't know how big the impact is. So that's why last time when I met with STH, I suggested that the two of you should work together to find out the relationship between the two. If you find that there is no relationship between MLA and the rental market, I won't ask anything about that at all in future. But some members do consider that there is a relationship between MLA and the rental market, and we must study rent control. So I would like to be more lenient. I hope that you will really study the matter. He said yes. STH said that he would study the subject with you. So this is not talking about disbursement of rental allowance, but the relationship between MLA and the rental market. So I would like to ask you again the question. You said before there is a relationship between MLA and the rental market. Are you willing to work with THB on this? Mr. Chairman, first of all, I want to understand what is meant by study. For me, study will be a more serious study. But if you were just talking about the relationship between MLA and the rental market, I hope you would understand that the rental market and the ML will affect the behavior of the property owner and the person renting the flat. So there is a dynamics between the two, and it is a dynamic situation. And there are a lot of economic studies telling us the relationship for such dynamic situations. So I think we would make reference to these economic studies, and we will not conduct a study ourselves. So Chairman, Secretary is saying indirectly that he will look at some documents, some economic studies, and he will not conduct any study because there are already some documentation on that. Okay, so you are saying that I have to ask STH whether there will be rent control, right? Well, of course, he did not say the last sentence, but I think that is what he meant because he is saying that there is a lot of study saying that there is a relationship between the two and I should go to THB. So, having listened to what you said today, I would ask THB not to conduct any study because SL has said that this is not a meaningful study. Either you have rent control or no. Well, Mr. Chairman, I hope Mr. Michael Tim will only say what he meant and will not put words into my mouth because I think what he say is what he said and not what I have said. I'm just asking, you to do a comprehensive study. You can engage consultants and experts to do it. But you said that there are already previous studies and there are documentation. So are you saying that there are documentation saying that there is no relationship between MLA and the rental market? What exactly do you mean? Chairman, I hope you would really listen to what I said, as although I'm already retweeting myself. Study between rental allowance and the rental market would require an experiment. And I don't think we would do an experiment. That's why I say we would not do a study. But if you want to say you want to know the relationship between the two, I was saying that we don't need to do it ourselves, and we can look at the documentation of previous economic studies, because there is a dynamic situation here. So I already repeated myself for 2 to 3 times. So will you be doing an experiment? Chairman, I have already said no. Well, then I'm really confused. If you say that there are documentation saying that there is a relationship and there is a need to do an experiment, and you say you won't do an experiment, and you said you believe in the study of the documentation of the study, so who should I be talking to, SLW or STH? Or are you just saying that I should go to STH for rent control? So I'm really confused. I don't know what the government wants to do, although I'm really not intelligent. Of course, you know, my intelligence quotient is not as high as SLW. Well, Chairman, members, I appreciate you really didn't get your answer, but I appreciate your point. Chairman, can I just interject? Well, for other countries, they have different provinces, they have different cities, and they can do different experiments. But for Hong Kong, we have only one city, and we have only one market here, whether you're in Tin Shui Wai or in Taiwan. So it is very difficult to do an experiment in Hong Kong. Well, I hope you can have a debate in a different forum. I don't think today is a good forum for this debate. I would like to handle the motion proposed by the Vice Chair. Mr. Xiu Kachin, well, since the government has not conducted a comprehensive study of the basic expenditure since 1996 and have not reviewed the eligibility for CSSA, so that the CSSA is not in time to meet the timely need. So I urge the government to conduct a scientific study to review the CSSA and also the standard rates under the CSSA. Members in favor, please raise your hands. So I think all members agree with the motion. So motion passed.
Hello.
Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, for the first round. Shall we get on with the second round first? Mr. Kwok Wai come back for the first round. Dr. Fernando CHEUNG, I'd like to spend a little time following up on Mr. Michael Tin, that the government policy formulation should be evidence-based. Now, the fact is plain that there are so many poor people who are looking for accommodation in the market to satisfy their needs. Under this present system, they simply cannot address their needs because of the exceedingly low rent allowance. You said that if you hike the rent allowance, then there will be a different dynamics altogether in the market, because everything will rise and you are pouring money. Spending money in a bad way. The rent is really ridiculous. Shouldn't it be right for the government to introduce some rent control? The answer is a plain yes. The government is saying that that would affect the supply, and there are other suggestions about other measures. The government is saying that they cannot do this without affecting the others, and they end up doing nothing. And as a result, the government is just dishing out some sweeteners to please the people. Mr. Secretary, you are an academic yourself, and I don't think this is not worthy of your status as an academic, because this is wholly arbitrary. You're not doing something in your power to help the members of the public. You're not using the resources to help the members of the public. You're evading. You're tiptoeing around the issue. The same can be said about the WFA, the Working Family Allowance, and you're applying these harsh working hours to determine the level that they are getting in terms of WFA. Now, you are saying that there is unemployment and the economy is slipping, and I think you are lagging really behind. You don't have the commitment to do something to help those who are in need. Why don't you do something good? Why don't you do us a good turn? Well, this term of administration should pack up and go as soon as possible to be replaced by another one. But we cannot do anything. We don't have a democratic system to vote you out of office. I think you ought to do something good for the public. For the WFA, these people are on such pathetically low pay, and they have children to look after. Something should be done for them. I mentioned the allowance of those working in the sheltered workshops. Will you address this as well? Secretary, Chairman, for the working families allowance, the working hours are not particularly harsh. Now, we were talking about 35 hours per week. Those getting the full rate, and they have to work 45 hours per week. Now, if you say that 45 hours per week or 35 hours per week are construed as harsh, I don't think that you would get a lot of agreement there. As to the sheltered workshops, in our rehabilitation plan, we did have some discussion. We're conducting the third round of consultation, and we hope that by the time we're done with the plan, we will bring members up to date on the situation. Dr. Cheung, harsh because they are on such low pay and are working 45 to 40 hours per week on such low pay. And this should not happen. This shouldn't have happened in the first place. That's how harsh the situation is. Mr. Sukachun has got another motion. We don't have the quorum to handle this motion. Members are at the other conference room attending another meeting. Mr. Kwok Wai Kong is not here with us. Mr. Xiu is taking the floor for the second round. Also, a CSSA review. Now, for the children, the long-term supplement, before 1999, able-bodied people, elderly, disabled people, they get one-off long-term supplement for them to buy the daily necessities. But in 1999, the basic needs have been neglected. The able-bodied and children lost their long-term supplement. Those between 60 and 65, they have lost this grant for them to buy the durable goods. Why is it that you're not making up for this inadequacy and reissue such grants? Secretary, well, the factors that we take into account are that we're trying to encourage employment. Long-term supplements mean that they are on a long-term basis, and we're encouraging people to hold down a job, and through the disregarded earnings and they will be able to earn more than what they would be given in terms of the long-term supplement. So the best way to help them improve the lot would be to encourage them to hold down a job. Mr. Xiu, I disagree with the fact that this is a comprehensive review. The Secretary said that the review is about the employment aspect. I'd like to put a question about the those paying rent exceeding the MRA. The Secretary said that it would take 3 to 4 years to look at the rent control. What measures will be adopted to alleviate the plight of these people? I don't want to go into detail in the interest of time. What measures do you have to alleviate the burden of those who are paying rent exceeding the MRA? Secretary, Chairman, under the CCF, we do have a program which will be extended to April next year. We are keeping a close eye on the situation. By the time the FC has endorsed the proposal to effect the adjustment, we hope that come the 1st of February, the adjustment will take place. We will monitor the situation to see whether there are other measures that will be required, like the use of certain funds to offer further assistance to people in this category. Dr. Fernando CHEUNG, I would like to have a go for the third round. I must say that we have another motion to deal with. Dr. CHEUNG, I'd like to follow up on the dental treatment, the grant for dental treatment. Now, for non-elderly able-bodied people, including children, they will be given back the grant to cover dental treatment. This is a necessity for the CSSA recipients who are mentally disabled. They have to go to the dental clinic accredited by the government. These NGOs are on the list, these accredited clinics. They have to seek a quotation, and with this quotation, they can undergo the dental treatment. The five dental clinics servicing the mentally disabled, these five are not on the list of the accredited clinics. So shouldn't you incorporate these into the list? I have first-hand experience myself. These disabled people, they're not welcome at the general dental clinics. So isn't it right for you to incorporate these five clinics into the accredited list? Because there is a need to seek quotation, this is causing some trouble to the elderly people and the mentally disabled, because they have to do the runaround. These elderly people, they are troubled by the toothache, and they need immediate treatment. And you're asking them to seek a quotation. Why don't you allow these accredited dental clinics? Now, you must have some faith in these clinics. I don't think the dentists would do any procedures that are not necessary, and they can get the treatment there for their ailment, and then they get the reimbursement. That would save the elderly folks a lot of running around, and they may delay the matters for a couple of days as a result. Secretary, Chairman, I think I have more or less addressed the question. The list of dental clinics serving the mentally disabled. I'm not familiar with these entities myself. I'll undertake to go away and take a look. Dr. CHEUNG, I mentioned streamlining the application procedures again. I'll have a look when I go back. But I think we need to liaise with the NGOs to have a package of measures, like there ought to be a laundry list of items that will be taken into account. I would agree with Dr. Cheung that it would be hard for the elderly to go around different places if they're having toothache. Well, shall we deal with Mr. Xiu's motion? Mr. Xiu, since the government still insists on the 1999 guiding principles, which biased the labeling of the CSS recipients as lazy people, and in 1999, CSS has been massively slashed and they have not made up for the shortfall, we urge the administration to come up with a report and publish on the report so that people will understand the objectives of the CSA's policy and the way in which the policies are formulated. All right, for those in favor, unanimously endorsed. Thank you. Mr. Pun Xiuping for the first round, please. Thank you. I wasn't going to speak. I had to attend another meeting next door. We were all concerned about the CSSA. The secretary mentioned all these improvement measures. Now, that the measures to encourage employment, I'd like to seek further elucidation. The economic situation is going to be getting worse, and we saw a reduction in the number of CSSA recipients in the past, but it seems that after December, after the Christmas holidays, things would leave a lot to be desired, and I'm sure that the jobless rate is going to creep up further. So does the government have any ideas about the level, the number of recipients going forward? Also, in terms of employment, through the Labor Department, you have the employment program for elderly and middle-aged, and this has been launched already. As a result of this program, how many elderly people have sought help from the Labor Department? What is the success rate? What sort of jobs and how many working hours do they get as a result of this program? Also, in the light of the current situation, you are launching this love upgrading special scheme. What courses are you making available to the participants? What sort of jobs are you including for these jobless people? Thank you.
John.
Mr. Secretary, Chairman, for the two last questions concerning the EPEM, I remember that the figures released to the panel several months ago. I think I'll try to ask the Labor Department for the latest figures and then I will provide them to members. On the love upgrading program, similarly, I don't have the details at hand, but I do recall that there are several dozen courses. If members are interested, I will provide the information after this meeting. But I seem to recall that you do have the list because we have passed that to you before, but I will go back and look into it. As regards the unemployment rate, between July to September, the unemployment rate has increased from 2.8% to 3.9% as compared to the previous 3 months. So if we look at the month of September, I think there is also increase of unemployment cases under the CSSA recipients. If the unemployment situation is generally increasing, then I think the cases of unemployment under the CSSA will similarly increase. Do you have any estimates, Mr. Secretary? Do you have any sort of funds set aside available for the purpose of helping the situation? I don't have any particular plans for extra allowance at this stage, but for this financial year, for the first half of this financial year, I think generally the number of CSSA cases are decreasing. So I do believe that we do have sufficient funds available for the purpose under the CSSA, even under an unemployment situation. But if the unemployment situation is really worsening quickly, then we may need to look at the figures again. But it seems that the trend is not that worrying at this stage. So for the third round, Dr. Fernando Cheung, Mr. Chairman, I would like to follow up on the rehab allowance and the medical allowance. I personally have come across a lot of cases, a lot of persons with disabilities, or some people, they may not be defined as having disability. It is difficult for them to apply for funds for rehab appliances. Some of them may even be defined as able-bodied. So I have received complaints that the occupational therapists may suggest them to use certain wheelchairs with some functions, but when they apply for that under the CSSA, they will not get the approval. They will be only given one fixed amount, which is not enough for buying a wheelchair with some special functions. So I think a lot of members have come across similar cases. Recently, I come across one case. When the wheelchair was purchased, it was not bought by CSSA allowance. So that means the person has used other resources for buying the wheelchair. So for the maintenance of the wheelchair, it will not be covered by the CSSA. So for that PWD, it is a very difficult situation because he doesn't have a lot of income and the wheelchair is just a basic need. And if a professional advise him to use a certain type of wheelchair, he will not be able to get funds for that under the CSSA. So these are very difficult situations. So I'm not sure whether you have to do something about the guidelines for disbursing the funds or the mechanism. So do you have experts within the Social Security team? Do you have an assessment of the recipient, or do you just look at their papers and the case? So I hope that the Social Security Division will take into account the views of the professionals who are working in the rehab field. If they make suggestions for using a certain requirement, they can give you maybe some quotations and you can choose the lowest one. And I hope that you will not turn out the applications right away. Have you received the mechanism for processing such cases? Mr. Chairman, for the current review, we have not taken that into account. We did not look at the sort of procedures. We just look at the items under the existing mechanism to see whether they are covered under the current system. Well, of course, apart from the government and the HA, there are other charitable trusts providing assistance to the needy. But of course, I will take into account what Mr. Fernando Cheung has said, and we will try to see if there is room for improvement. And I would also ask my frontline staff to give a detailed explanation to the applicants, because I think we have to be clear about the procedures and the guidelines. Well, thank you, members, for your questions. We have completed the question time. So the government is hoping to put the paper to the Finance Committee, and I hope members would support the proposal of this putting this funding bid to the FC. So members all agree. Thank you. Any other business? If there are no other business, I would call the meeting to a close.